Hello and welcome to India's World. Today we are going to discuss the spread of Islamic Jihad to Europe in the context of the attack on the satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo and a Jewish supermarket in France. Muslim communities, as we know, have existed in Europe for centuries. Guest worker agreements and relaxed immigration policies in the 1960s brought waves of Muslim immigrants from Turkey into Germany, from Algeria into France, and from Pakistan into the United Kingdom. However, it is only in the last decade that youngsters born and educated in Europe have tended to become radicalized. It is now well known that both European converts as well as Muslim immigrants and their children have gone to fight in Syria. France has the largest Muslim population of any European country. It also has the largest number of citizens fighting in Syria with the Islamic State, followed by citizens of the United Kingdom, Germany, Belgium, the Netherlands, and Italy. There are also US and Australian citizens fighting with the Syrian opposition, but in much smaller numbers. There are fears that when these fighters return home, more radicalized than ever before, they could incite other volunteers towards terrorism. To understand the terrorist strikes in France and the spread of Islamic radicalism in Europe, we have with us three distinguished experts. We have with us Ambassador Sibal, Kanwal Sibal, a former foreign secretary, one of our most distinguished diplomats. He's been India's ambassador to France, Egypt, Turkey, and Russia. We have with us Ambassador Ranjit Singh, Kalha. He retired as secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs, was India's ambassador in Iraq and in Indonesia. And we have with us a well-known figure in Delhi and old friend of mine, Dr. Awwad. He's the chief of bureau of the Syrian Arab news agency, SANA, for South Asia, based in New Delhi. I welcome all of you to this discussion. Ambassador Sibal, let me begin with you. Do you think that these attacks by Islamic terrorists in Paris are both a result of tension between the state-imposed secularism of France, which is seen as anti-Muslim, banning the burqa in public, banning the hijab for girls in school, the far right and its pronouncements on Islam on the one hand, and on the other hand, the developments in the Middle East?
Well, I think of these three factors, I would give the least importance to the first one, because those restrictions are imposed also on Christians and Jews, and even on the minority of Sikhs there who want to wear turbans or even handkerchiefs on their heads, and they're not allowed to do so. I think these issues, this point is being raised by people from the outside who don't understand the nature of French secularism, which is very strongly entrenched in France.
Entrenched in the state, not necessarily in the people.
In the people
too. State imposed.
In the people too. And then there are other issues which we need not get into in terms of equality of women, gender equality and things like that. And then in any case, one must also point out that there is no restriction on wearing burqas and anything else in private spaces. It's only in public spaces that this is not allowed, or in public institutions. If you go to a private school, you can do it. Anyway, insofar as the two other issues are concerned, yes, there could be contributory factors, because French interventions in West Asia, in Libya, in Syria, yes, could have caused concerns amongst sections of the Muslim community, because to my mind, it was not terribly necessary for France to take the lead in Libya, for instance, and expose themselves, etc., etc. But insofar as the third element is concerned, yes, these are contributory factors, but I don't think that this is a sufficient explanation for the kind of problems that France or other European countries are facing in terms of alienation of their Muslim populations.
Okay. Let me take that question to Ambassador Kalha. What are the factors which are sort of leading European Muslim youth to support radical Islam or even join these Islamic groups? Why would youngsters educated in Europe, brought up in Europe, born in Europe, leave the security of their families, leave the security of their societies, and be impacted by what's happening in the Middle East?
This is largely because of alienation of the Muslims in several European countries. I can give you the example of UK. They tend to live in ghettos, which are basically Muslim ghettos. They live there, they go to school in those areas, and they are subject to a lot of propaganda which comes in.
So they voluntarily ghettoize themselves, or the society ghettoizes them?
I think it happens because, you see, they feel comfortable with each other. They don't want to have neighbors who are alien to their societies, to their way of thinking. So what happens is this ghettoization takes place. One family moves in, another one moves in, and a third one moves in, and suddenly the whole street is just, say, for example, from Muslims from Pakistan. That kind of situation prevails. And then they feed on each other's insecurities. And particularly, like, jobs are not very available very often. And the kind of taunting that goes on in social circles perhaps leads them to believe that it would be a much better society if it was a radicalized Islamic society. And of course, the local societies also don't help, because they also tend to taunt them very often, like walking on the street or wearing, say, the burqa, or perhaps having customs which are alien to those local societies. So this kind of alienation does take place. And don't forget, there is a huge amount of propaganda which comes in, not only through the internet, through music, through what do you call, through books, through what do you call, lectures in the local mosque, which influences a young mind. And therefore, the belief is sort of sustained that if you were to turn to radical Islam, or if you were to turn to a purer Islam, perhaps life would be much better. Okay. I think that is one of the main causes.
We could discuss the impact of social media in the discussion further on. Dr. Awwad, do you agree with those who say that the Iraq war was the defining moment for Muslims in France and other European countries, which sowed the seeds of discontent, which has led to the present harvest of terrorism? And also, for some people, when the West did nothing, when 160,000 people died in Syria, it fed their frustration and sort of impelled them to join these jihadi groups.
Well, I think I will go back to what your introductory remarks you have started, that it has been a decade back. In fact, it is more than a decade. I would say it is from the First World War. It's a colonial attitude that among the European country that they have generated, that they have recruited people from different parts of the world and they brought them into their own country, and they tried to integrate them, right? Whether they were building their own, whether they were just a laborer has been immigrated there. So all these people have been integrated into the society, and they were trying to be the second generation, third generation, become a German or a French citizen or a British citizen. So all of them has been, but there are two, three issues we have to address very carefully here. One is the social transformation within the society in Europe, which is showing the rising of the right-wing people and the homogeneous society, which is rejecting the multicultural society anymore. And Merkel was the first one to speak about it in Germany, that it is a failure, the multiculture. And people talking of a unicultural now, back into European hegemony of
Isn't
being...
Isn't that unfair to Europe? I mean,
no, it's not unfair.
Look at Britain today. It's a multicultural society. Never before, it's become a much more tolerant society. France is a multicultural society. There may be segments which are of the extreme right. But to describe all these societies as societies that are trying to homogenize, I think is unfair. They're actually trying to heterogenize.
That is what exactly is happening. That's why the right wing in Europe is waning and gaining grounds. And that is why this anti-Islamophobia, which is created there, it's a part of the agenda which they are trying to promote the majority of the Europeans.
So Iraq war and developments in West Asia had nothing to do with it?
Absolutely it has. That is what I'm saying. That is an additional factor to the foreign policy of the French and the Britishers and the European toward the Arab world. Look at what happened in North African state. Look what happened in Mali and Chad. Look what's happening in Syria and Iraq, and even in Afghanistan. All these issues compiled together have led to this kind of resentment among the minority. Okay. And that most important part, which we are not also focusing, allowing imams from radical countries, whom you're taking them as the champion of your leadership in democracy in the Arab world, are teaching these people and showing them picture to recruit them into jihadists into this part of the world.
But let me go back to France for a minute, Ambassador Sibal. Do you see this unprecedented international support, marching together of all the world leaders in support of Charlie Hebdo cartoonists and the victims there? It's a bit disturbing because our liberal instincts do not seem to allow us to see that there is a distinct difference between freedom of speech and speech that provokes humor that is puerile or that borders on hate speech. So as a liberal, I would say I'm for freedom of speech. As a newspaper editor, I would be extremely reluctant to publish, you know, more than half of the cartoons that Charlie Hebdo published.
Well, one explanation is that in France there is a very deeply entrenched culture of satire. and they don't see it that way. And there are individuals, and there's a tradition of attacking institutions. And attacking religion as an institution is considered fair game. And Charlie Hebdo was not only targeting the Islamic community, but equally the Christians and the Jews and others.
They were attacking all religious puffery and pretentiousness. Yeah. But now, is that a good enough excuse to say
the country believes, the people believe, and the state believes in freedom of expression and don't see anything terribly wrong in attacking any institution, including religious institutions, and if the legal framework doesn't allow the state to take action, then what does the state do? Now, one can agree on terms of common sense that if you are going to, in some ways, make mockery of the prophet of a particular religion, there would be a reaction. Many people will feel offended. They'll think it's in bad taste, it's provocative, etc., etc. But at the end of it, nothing, but absolutely nothing justifies an individual to take the law into his own hands and go and kill people because the cartoon is offensive.
I am not on that point at all. I'm merely saying, even in India, for example, we have freedom of speech guaranteed by the Constitution.
No, but
subject to reasonable restrictions.
Yes.
So you're saying it's purely a legal thing in France, is it?
No, no, in the sense that matter has gone to tribunals. Yep. Actually, Kabu, one of the cartoonists who was killed, has been hauled before tribunals, including by Marie Le Pen, and he has won those cases. So there is a justice, there are legal pronouncements by the tribunals and the courts in France which do not see this kind of drawing, these kind of drawings as being impermissible or would need to be banned or restricted in any way.
All right. We need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again in a bit. Stay with us. Welcome back. We're discussing the spread of jihad in Europe, Islamic radicalization in Europe, in the context of the terrorist attacks in Paris. Ambassador Kalha, did most of these European groups originate as local initiatives which indoctrinated the youngsters, as he's suggesting, through mosques, through radical imams, in global jihadi ideology, and therefore created a fertile ground for these people to then form links with international jihadi groups or jihadi groups in West Asia?
See, what happened was that because they were allowed to travel, particularly from countries which were already very radicalized, and there was no restriction on their coming in, either into European countries. And therefore, take the example of the British, their attitude was that, look, let them come, let them speak, and if they don't do any harm, if they don't do any physical harm, what's the problem of letting them make speeches, however radical they may be? They're just letting off steam. And at that particular time, do remember also that they thought that this, what they call radical Islam or jihadi Islam, would never come and touch them, and that it would always go towards, say, perhaps countries like India or other places, and that therefore they were immune from any kind of jihadi, what they call, action. Little did they realize that what they were actually fostering was something even more, dangerous than what was happening, say, for example, the kind of terrorists which cross over. Because, you see, these people, they are now having links all over. Yeah. And they find that the ground is very fertile populations in Europe are concerned, Muslim populations in Europe are concerned.
My question is, what kind of challenge does it pose, this process of radicalization? It's not a one-off radicalization, it's a slow process of radicalization. Some people have called it the slow fuse of Islamic radicalism in Europe. What kind of challenge does it pose to European governments?
I think it's a wake-up call for whole Europe now. This attack have really make them rethink about their strategy toward the Arab world, toward the Arab North African state and Syria. In fact, they have never learned from what happened in Afghanistan, the culture of jihadists they have promoted. And besides, when they were in our country, they were rebels and freedom fighters and champions of freedom. But when they go and attack their country, they are terrorists. So you don't have two different explanation for the same person.
So you're saying that the Europeans allowed the citizens
absolutely
to go to Syria as so-called freedom fighters to resist the regime of President Assad?
Yes.
So it, at that point, they were acceptable. When they come back, they're not acceptable.
We have more than 10,500 blue eyes, European in Syria and in Iraq, fighting along with the ISIS. They started now feeling the heat when they start going back. Yeah. Rehabilitation, de-radicalization has become a big problem. Yeah. They even cut their connection with the Syrian government to talk on the terms of security and those captured. The problem here lies in that we have to expose the nexus between the foreign policy of the countries involved in the Syrian affairs or in the Arab affairs, including Sarkozy first, when he was even promised to get one free jet from Qatar if he attacks Syria. So what kind of foreign policy are you running in that part of the world?
I really don't want to go into Syrian government's own policies. So we'll leave that for a minute. We'll leave that for a minute. Ambassador Sibal, do you think because EU's cross-border restrictions are minimal, and some European countries also tried very hard not to disturb the Muslim communities in the hope that radicalism will never come here, as Ambassador Kalha suggested. Has this made it difficult to catch both departing jihadis who are going to West Asia and also departees who arrive back after training there?
I think in terms of stopping people from going to these hotspots, the governments are now trying to monitor this very closely. And to some extent, they can succeed. But then, you know, they can't impose a ban on foreign travel by Muslims as a whole. And you never know which Muslim youngster intends eventually to land up in Turkey or in Syria.
Intelligence agencies all over do profiling.
Right. But if somebody is not in your list and has not attracted attention and is a kind of a sleeper cell, if you like, then you'll miss it. Insofar as people coming back are concerned, I think that will be easier to monitor, even if their internal movement in EU is free, because they have Europol and everything else. Yeah. They're very intensive arrangements within Europe to monitor these kind of radicalized people and groups. So that should be easier to handle. But individuals can always escape this net. And can cause damage.
But the individuals involved are huge. I mean,
not really.
The last figure I saw for France in 1 year, 700 people.
Yeah. Yes, who've gone there to fight to Syria and this and that and that. But this doesn't necessarily mean that all of them intend to come back and start bombings in Paris and other places. I mean, you can't reach this conclusion automatically. Some of them may have been idealistic people. Who actually feel that the West policies towards these countries are wrong, and et cetera, et cetera. Or they are being motivated by some other considerations. It doesn't necessarily mean they become terrorists in terms of causing terrorist attacks in their own countries.
High probability of their being indoctrinated, though.
Could be, yeah. Yes.
Okay, Ambassador Kalha, no group has has taken responsibility for the Paris attacks as yet, although one eyewitness said that one of the shooters said they were operating on behalf of Al-Qaeda in Yemen. But my point is, do you think group affiliation is becoming much less important than the ideology which motivates these youngsters or small groups of jihadis to act on their own, select their own targets and carry out these attacks?
No, obviously they are affiliated with some group or the other because...
is that group affiliation necessary? Ideologically, if you take your inspiration is the same, you don't have to be part of Al-Qaeda and be taking commands from them. Then there is, I'm saying, is there an autonomy then? Choose your own targets and attack them.
See, to do individual action is very difficult. They need backup support. And clearly, this attack in Paris had a lot of backup support because you can't do these kind of things. You can't bring in AK-47s and you can't bring in various things unless you have group support. And don't forget that the initial, initiation of these people into jihadi, activities takes place through an organization. Somebody recruits them. They're not individually going there and say, okay, I want to go to a shop, I buy an AK-47 and let me take action. It's not that kind of thing. It is a group support.
Okay, all right. We need to take a break again at this point. We'll be back again in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing Islamic radicalization in Europe in the context of the terrorist attacks in Paris. Dr. Awwad, this issue of linkages with various groups in the Middle East. Don't you think one of the challenges that European intelligence agencies face now is the following? That the youngsters are getting radicalized without even going for training in the Middle East. That It's only a powerful jihadi ideology they need to adhere to. They can make their own bombs. They can procure their own weapons. I don't think weapon procurement is as difficult in some places as Ambassador Kalha makes out. I think it's fairly easy to get weapons in the international market today. And then identify their targets and attack them.
Well, I think there are two issues here. One, you have to see the social networking, which made it easier for any group all over the world to act within a matter of minutes, yeah. That they can be sleeping cell, they can be activated, and they have done, unlike during the old times.
Sleeping cell, even then involves a linkage of some kind.
No, linkage has to be there. See, if you don't give money, nobody going to kill himself. If you don't give money and you don't intoxicate the person by teaching him wrong, then he will not go and blow up himself. Why he has to blow up? For what cause? If he has been living, he's a French citizen, he is living in Europe, he's the third generation from the...
Don't undermine the powerfulness of ideology. People went
then,
and
then you are
fought
promoting.
Fascism in, I am, in Spain.
You see, I am trying to be realistic in my presentation to tell you how what happened, because I'm giving you the background. Most of the border, 900 kilometers open with Turkey, was run by the mercenaries from Europe. So you don't want to tell me that Europeans did not know who went to Syria. They know in the ABC every person. They even were running ads in the newspaper.
All that is known. I'm merely saying that today, without going to Syria, without going to Iraq, if you adhere to an extremist ideology, you can procure
weapons.
How you
will adhere to extremist ideology if you don't have somebody teaching you the Wahhabism inside the mosque and telling you that your people are being killed somewhere else and you should go and kill?
Okay, let me take that question to you, Master Sibal. So what he's pointing to really is social media. So what is the role that social media has played in recruiting the jihadis? Because today, you could be sitting in Syria and Iraq, and you could be communicating to impressionable youngsters in Europe through YouTube, through Instagram, through Twitter, through Tumblr, and recruiting them and telling them what to do.
I think this is a problem, and all governments are sensitive, including our own government. And there is potential for recruitment of impressionable youngsters, precisely of the kind you mentioned, for the causes you mentioned. But at the same time, I think we should not exaggerate the whole thing beyond a certain point. And we must be very clear in mind what the scope and dimension of the problem is. It is obviously clear that a handful of people in a democratic society can cause a lot of mayhem. But one should also give the impression that the Muslim communities of Europe or in France are all of them in their entirety now vulnerable to this kind of a propaganda, and that their alienation with their own society is so deep that they are obvious recruits for this kind of a thing, and tomorrow the whole problem of terrorism will go beyond control. I don't think it'll remain limited. It'll pose a challenge, because even one person killed, even one small attack,
it can be a
formidable destabilizing
challenge. At the height of the insurgency in Northern Ireland, the provisional IRA was only 400 active weapon-holding people.
True.
If you look at insurgencies in India...
But there was a much bigger cause there.
Sorry?
There was a big territorial cause
there.
So
I'm saying
that
to create mayhem in our societies, you don't need everybody to get radicalized. A handful of people
are
enough.
Then we have to go to a different question, which is, we all say that, look, Islam is a peace-loving religion. No religion teaches you to kill innocents. Terror has no religion. The vast majority of Muslims are law-abiding. They're well integrated. They want to live peacefully. Now, if this is the situation, then automatically the conclusion would be the thing can be controlled by this vast majority, then at a certain point asserting itself and isolating these people. And then, of course, international pressure on the governments and on religious institutions and, you know, who are behind all this.
And de-radicalization and so on and so forth.
This and that. Yeah. So let's first be very clear in our mind as to what is the scope of the problem. Now, if you accept the first proposition that the vast majority do not want this, then I think this problem can be controlled if that vast majority gets mobilized after attacks like this, which have shocked the consciousness of the world, and then try and do something.
Yeah. Okay. Master Kalha, two more pragmatic things. Has Turkey become the gateway of European jihadis to Syria and Iraq? Because up to now, if you read all the reports, youngsters are traveling all the way to Turkey. They mix with people. They look like tourists. They cross the border, take a taxi, and they become a jihadis. And this is the same route they take if they survive the jihad to come back. And now that Turkey itself has become a target of terrorist attack, we saw an attack last week. Do you think Turkey needs to do more to monitor its borders? I mean, what kind of a nation is it which does not even control its border with Syria?
You see, you have to go back a little bit into history. See, there is a Turkish ambition to play a very leading role in the affairs of the Middle East. Don't forget, it's the ex-colonial power in that region. And secondly, Turkey also sees itself as a kind of a small, a major champion of Sunni rights in the Middle East. So therefore, if you fuel a Sunni jihadist movement, which basically this is what the ISIS is, you will then also have to then open your borders to let people cross, because after all, it would need support. On the other hand, what you do find is that most of this insurgency, which is now coming in into this thing, is going through Turkey, because on the other side, there are Shia communities who would not let these people go through. So therefore, you do find that the role of Turkey is a very important role as far as this issue is concerned.
Okay. My last question to you, a yes and no answer. Do you think, in view of what's happening now, Europe will become more xenophobic, more nationalistic?
That is what they are after all. This is the fact.
No, they are not like that, but will they become like that?
That is what the trends. It is an Islamophobia which has been created. There are more nationalists that coming up in the future.
I don't think so. I think the common sense will prevail, and I do hope perhaps they take a leaf out of India. We look at the way we handle this thing. Okay. We talk about, you know, sarv dharam sadbhav. That is what it should. Respect for all religions. That's what you should do.
Well, certainly not in France, because this whole idea of this whole march was in fact to prevent a kind of a division within the communities in France, and the Muslim community participated in this also. I think the overall democratic culture and values of Europe will prevent this kind of serious Islamophobia or xenophobia within the country.
Yeah. Okay, on that happy note, hopeful note, we bring this discussion to an end. I'd like to thank all my guests, Dr. Awwad, Ambassador Ranjit Singh Kalha, Ambassador Kanwal Sibal, for coming here and discussing this issue. That's all we have for you today. We'll be back again next week, of course. Till then, goodbye, and thanks for watching.